Would you like to take your seats, please? It's wonderful to know the peace and joy that Jesus has provided for us. Wonderful to gather. It's a beautiful sunny day. The sun always shines in Eastbourne, eh? It's, every week I've come, the sun's shone. It's just amazing. And it's a blessing to be in not only in the sunshine, but in the grace of God together, celebrating what it is that he's accomplished for us. And I want to just underline again that truth of the grace of God that is so releasing to us, so sets us free from every other pressure, every other challenge that might come our way. God wants us secure in his grace. He wants us to receive that peace, that joy, that certainty, that we can serve him from a glad and generous heart, not trying to do stuff to somehow please him, but to know, no, he's pleased because of what Jesus did. We're freed because of what Jesus did, and that liberates us just to live for him. I want to speak to you on that theme this morning, just once again to mention those books at the back, God's Treasure Possession, this new book, please take advantage of that being there, and also God's Lavish Grace. I really want to encourage you to dig into that, get secure in it. It's life-changing for us to really know the grace of God. And you know, we sometimes see it. I know when I first saw the grace of God, I felt like I saw a gap in the clouds. And then it kind of closed. I thought, did I see something? And I felt God whispered in my heart, I will persuade you that it's true. The grace that changed everything. And yeah, he did. He persuaded me. But sometimes you kind of drift back. You kind of drift. You think, oh Lord, show me again. And just to nail it. I want to encourage you, take advantage of those books being there. If you don't have cash, you can pay by card. Okay, I'm just going to read a couple of verses from Hebrews chapter 9, which says this, for if the blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkling those who've been defiled sanctify for the cleansing of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. I'm going to concentrate on that last phrase in a moment. Holy Spirit, we believe in the Holy Spirit. We believe, Lord Jesus, you triumphed. We praise you that you took our guilt, we took our shame. Your blood was poured out that we might have a conscience cleansed. Well, what a privilege, a clean conscience as a gift. We're so grateful. And Holy Spirit, I just ask you right now, come please, rest upon us. Come and be our teacher. Come open the eyes of our hearts. Come set us free. Let your truth do us good, we pray, Father. So own your word in our hearts, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The blood of Jesus cleanses our conscience from dead works. What do you think the writer means when he talks about dead works? I think we as evangelicals, we tend to think of dead works as being kind of formal religion, people doing externalism, you know, that into all kinds of stuff. We think, no, we're not into that. We don't need candles. We don't need statues. We don't need icons. It's all, we're not into that. We're not into dead religion. We're into something more vibrant than that. And yet I'd like us to be kind of a little bit more self-critical and just to open our hearts a bit, because, you know, I think death kind of creeps in. You go across this nation today, you see so many buildings that used to be churches. You see that, you know, they're warehouses now, or they're shops, or they're libraries. But you look at the architecture, you think, that used to be a church. And all over the country, there's kind of, death has crept in where there used to be life. And I remember we had a tree in our garden, Wendy and I once, and it kind of just started dying. And it kind of died from the end of the branches. You saw this death kind of creep up. You said, oh gosh, what's happening to that tree? And after a few months, it was gone. Death kind of creeps in. So let's just be a little bit more self-critical and say, what is a dead work? So let me just remind you of some of the things the Bible says. A work without faith is a dead work. The Bible talks about works of faith. But if we're not with expectation, if we're going through the routine, it can happen. It can happen. What starts vibrant can become routine. You just kind of do it because, well, we've always done it. So, I mean, for instance, you know, you've come this morning, we're here together, some of us are watching online. But, you know, are you coming with faith? That's the danger sometimes. We get very passive when we are just watching online at home because we had to get used to that through their lockdown and so on. We can become quite passive. We're not coming with faith. You know, I've prayed a lot, I'm sure many of you have, for this morning, that we come with faith, that we come expecting something to happen. Because we're talking about the living God. I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. I believe in the Holy Spirit. So I want to see something happen. And so if we don't come with faith, actually, we may turn up. But is it living? We may be sitting at home on our couch listening, but God wants a work of faith, of faith. I remember once I was talking to one of the girls in the church I used to lead in Brighton, and she said, she told me this hilarious story. She said she asked her mother, why is it that when you do the roast, you always cut off the ends of the joint and put the two ends on the top? Well, why do you always do that? And her mother said, do you know, I don't really know. She said, Grandma used to do it. I think it may be something to do with the flowing of the juices of the meat. I'm not quite sure. But Grandma's coming next week. Ask Grandma. Because I don't really know. I've done it all my life. I've always done it. I don't know why we do it. So Grandma came the following week. She said, Grandma, let me ask you, why is it when we roast the joint, why do we cut off the ends and put it on top? Why do we do that? And the grandma said, you still do that? She said, yeah, why? She said, oh, I used to do it because the oven was so small, it was the only way I could get the meat in the oven. Well, we still do it because, well, why? We've always done it. Maybe that's why we're here this morning. Well, we've always done it. And death can creep in if there's no expectation. If there's no kind of, where's God? What's God going to do? It becomes dead. You have to watch out. It begins to creep in. Or another dead work might be, if you like, no kind of hope even. We may not have kind of certain faith, you know, like 10 people would be saved or something. But we might have, you remember the story of Jonathan and his armor bearer? They went out to fight. They didn't know what would happen, but they said, let's go. Perhaps, you get this word, perhaps. Perhaps the Lord will do. Perhaps. It's that kind of, well, we don't know what will happen, but maybe God will do something. Even if it's a work of hope, you're kind of leaning forward, a work of hope. That's a living work. Without hope. Another dead work I think you could find illustrated in the Old Testament again, when I love the story about the taking of Jericho. You remember they walked around Jericho 7 times, and it says in Hebrews chapter 11, by faith, the walls of Jericho fell down. You think, man, that's amazing. By faith, these walls fell, and they just took Jericho. And then the thing happens, this next thing that happened was this. Go and see what the next town's like. So they send some spies down to the next town, and they come back and say, oh, it's only a little town. It's not as big as Ai. We took Ai. We took Jericho. We can take Ai. Oh, just send a little army down. It's like, oh, okay, thank you for helping us with Jericho, Lord. It looks so big. Thanks for helping us. We can do this one. And they stepped out of faith into presumption. One step. Oh, we can do it. Wow. Did it become a dead work? Remember that story? They came to Ai, and the guys from Ai came out. They ran for their lives. They were defeated. From a glorious victory to defeat because, wow, we can do it now. They weren't looking to God. They weren't depending on God. Beloved, we've got to press forward as we evangelize Eastbourne, as we set up a great church here for the glory of Jesus. We need to lean into God all the time. God's doing something here. So not a presumptuous work and not a work that's not from God. Okay, this is for us as individually. To know, is this something God wants me to do? Again, when I was pastoring at Seaford originally, just along the coast, when I first left Bible College, and I was a pastor there, and you know, getting on, doing fine. And my old school was Brighton Grammar School, where I was ungodly, and then I got saved, and to be honest, I wasn't much better. And through my sixth form, I was terrible, an awful Christian. I mean, I was supposed to be a Christian. When I became a Christian, I put on a Christian Union badge. I was so excited. And the art teacher that I so admired, he looked at me and said, become one of those, have you? Badge came off quick. I was a useless Christian. And I remember that I got this message from the school. We hear that you are now a minister. We need someone to teach religious knowledge through the school. And we'd appreciate if you'd like to come in one day a week and teach. And I thought, wow, what a terrific opportunity. I can put things right that I got wrong. I was so excited. I can go back to my old school. I can do it. And I'm praying about it. You know, Lord, this is really exciting. And it's kind of like there's no answer from heaven. You think, you know the school, Lord? You know the school? Like, you know the school? You know, it's a terrific opening, Lord. You kind of nothing. What? And I thought God said to me, what did I tell you to do? I said, well, pastor this church. And there's this, no, just pastor this church. But Lord, there's such an open door. And I felt God said to me, it's not for you. And I got in touch with a friend who was a Youth of Christ worker, and somebody else followed that up and did that thing. You see, not every door that opens is necessarily yours. It's not something necessarily God wants you to do. You know, Peter said, I'm going fishing. He fished all night, caught nothing. God had not sent him to do it. And so we need to be careful, because you can be very actively in dead works. And some people are. Some people are super, super active. And it's like, I'm so pushing. I'm trying to please God. But is it what God wants? I just knew, hey, God wasn't in that for me. And I could have got my life really cluttered up, because I had to be committed every week. And soon after that, God began to draw me out to go out to other towns all around Sussex. And we started seeing churches started. If I'd committed myself, it would have messed me up. We need to know, is it from God? Otherwise, it's a dead work. It's not something God wants. Another dead work, just to go through a little list here, is one that's not motivated by love. You remember that amazing classic passage, 1 Corinthians 13. I can prophesy. I can speak in tongues. I can give away all my money. It says that if it's without love, it's nothing. Nothing. Gave away all my money. It's nothing. Wow, God's interested in some motivation here. My son, give me your heart. It's not just activity. It's not just I'm doing stuff. Because gradually, we begin doing stuff that actually we're not motivated to do. And that's what I want to get into this morning. Otherwise, it can be a dead work. It's interesting. You find in Revelation chapter 2, Jesus is speaking to the church at Ephesus. And in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, Paul is speaking to the church of Thessalonica. And Paul says to the church of Thessalonica, I know your labor of love, your work of faith, the steadfastness of your hope. And he's really commending them. He said, you're such a great church, your work of faith, your labor of love, the steadfastness of your hope. Later, Jesus writes to the church at Ephesus. He says, I know your labor. I know your work. I know you're steadfast, full stop. I know your labor, but it doesn't say I know your labor of love. It doesn't say I know your work of faith. I know you work. I know you're steadfast, but there's no hope. Love, faith, and hope have gone. It's just a shell now. And Jesus says to them at Ephesians, come back to the love you used to have, or I'll have to remove your lampstand. That's frightening. I mean, I wonder what a church without a lampstand looks like. That should frighten us. There's lots of buildings around here, all sorts of church buildings around this country, hundreds of them that are closed. There's something else now. And there must have come a moment when, you see, sometimes we say, oh, Satan's closed the churches. I don't know if Satan has authority to close churches. Jesus has. He's going to remove your lampstand. I'd hate to be the pastor of a church whose lampstand's gone. You see, God said to Saul, King Saul in the Old Testament, today the kingdom is removed from you. He said that to Saul. Today the kingdom's removed from you. That didn't mean he couldn't go into the throne room the next day. Didn't mean he couldn't walk into the palace. Didn't mean he couldn't sit on the throne. But from God's point of view, the kingdom's gone. And God can say to churches, I take your lampstand away. And as believers who love Jesus, we say, Lord, I don't want that. Please don't do that. We want to be full of faith. We want to see God do stuff, don't we? We don't want to just be passive. We just want to go through the motions, cutting off the meat. We don't know why. No, we're in here because our eyes are on God. Our hope's in him. We serve out of joy for him. But otherwise, you see, those become dead works. Now, let's just press it further. Why do we do dead works? Why do Christians do religious things which are kind of dead? Why do we do it? Well, I think the key is in what it says in the verse. It says, the blood of Jesus cleanses your conscience from dead works. I think we do dead works because we've got a bad conscience. We do stuff to get our conscience clear. We think, if I do this, God will be happy with me. If I do this, other people will think, oh, he's a good Christian, he does this, he turns up, she does that, she does. It kind of, we do it to cleanse our conscience. But the wonderful thing, and we've been singing about it, is the blood of Jesus cleanses my conscience. So I don't have to do any of this stuff to somehow please God. Right? That's what this verse is saying. We don't do things thinking, what will God think of me if I don't? What will they think of me if I don't? What will other people think of me if I don't do this stuff? You see, people will get caught up with that. It says in Romans 4, verses 4 and 5, to him who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is regarded as righteousness. The one who doesn't work, his faith is regarded as righteousness. It's done deal. It's a grace message. It's his faith that regards, he doesn't work. To him who doesn't work, his faith is regarded as righteousness. It's amazing, eh? I know, again, if I can go back to another personal experience, when I was at the church at Seaford, and we were, in the early years, I was trying to introduce life in the Spirit. And we were rather a conservative evangelical church, and I was kind of radical, really. I was trying to make the holy room for the Holy Spirit, and it took us some time to see that transition. And in the mercy of God, we kind of came through, and God was among us, and we were experiencing something of the presence of God like we've never done before. And you know, I thought, well, hallelujah, we're kind of getting healthy again. We're getting through, and I thought, well, you know, I felt God said to me, "You've been very inward looking. You've not related much to other churches across the area." I thought, no, that's true. We've been kind of looking in on ourselves. And so I went to the local fraternal, pastor's fraternal. And I said, may I please come? And they said, yeah, sure, come. You're welcome. I thought, well, thank you so much. We've been a bit busy, but hey, I'd love to identify with the broader church in the town. Great. Do you know, the next week, a guy came to my front door, I'd never seen before, not the door. Hello? And I said, I hear you're coming in with all the churches. So I said, we want to have more fellowship. He said, I'm so pleased. I said, oh, good. He said, next week, we're all going across the town, and we're going to put envelopes in all the homes across the town. And then we go back the week or two later and ask for all their money. So I said, I'm so glad you're coming in. So I said, I don't think we will come in on that. And he said, I heard you were coming in. I heard you were going to fellowship with us. What's he trying to do? I heard you. And I said, no, I think probably we're not. He said, all the churches do it. And he said, even the Roman Catholics join in. What's he trying to do? He's trying to make me feel guilty to make me do stuff. You see, that can happen. Even preachers can do it. Trying to make us feel guilty, to make us do stuff. And happily, I knew this. The blood of Jesus cleanses my conscience. So I said, no, thank you very much. Goodbye. And I'm still righteous. Hallelujah. See, I'm righteous because it's a gift. I'm not righteous because I did this stuff. Which, imagine I'd have to go to the church next week and say, and we're all going to go door to door. We are. Yes, we are. You know, you get caught. People get caught. It's individuals get caught. You say, would you do the children's work? Oh, I hate kids. They stink. They're horrible, noisy. Oh, yes, of course I will. I hate kids. No, but you know, but somebody, what will they think of me if I don't? You know, we need somebody to do, yeah. Oh. See, now this is where leaders of churches get nervous. They think, Terry, stop preaching now. I shall have to do everything from now on. Now I'm going to go on through the verse. So we're going to cleanse our conscience from dead works in order that we might serve the living God. Right, now this is a transition. Right? We don't want to be just religious. We don't want to just be doing stuff. I want, I'm sure you do, I want to serve the living God. Let me just remind you of a few famous Bible verses. Titus 2:14, Christ gave himself for us. We've just broken bread together. He gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity, purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good works. Right? He wants people zealous for good works. Right? Another one, Matthew 5:16, that men may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. So there's a greater motivation. God's gets glory. The third one, Jesus, John 9:14. We must work the works of him who sent me. The night is coming when no man can work. There's an end. The opportunity would be gone. We must work now. The night's coming where you can't do any more. And then the last one, Revelation 22:12. One of the last verses in the whole Bible. Behold, I'm coming quickly. My reward is with me to render to every man according to what he's done. According to what he's done. God wants to reward us according to what we've done. All right, so I'm not going to do conscience work. I'm not going to do things so that other people think well of me or somehow justify myself. Jesus has justified me. I'm not trying to impress God because Jesus has already impressed God. Hallelujah. I'm accepted in the beloved. Hallelujah. But I want to serve him. So I'm going to be careful what I get involved in. And it says here, he will reward us for what we've done. Now, you don't often hear Christians preach on rewards. It's something that we don't give a lot of thought to. But I'd like to remind you what it says. I just want to turn, if you want to turn. I'm going to read a few verses in 1 Corinthians 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, Paul talks about the fact he's laid a foundation, and then it talks about how it gets built with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw. Okay, so 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 12, he says, I've laid the foundation, which is Christ. If any man builds on the foundation, with gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, straw. Verse 13, each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it because it will be revealed with fire, and the fire itself will test the quality of each man's work. If any man's work which he's built on it remains, he will receive a reward. If any man's work is burned up, he will suffer loss. But he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. He's saved. It's not a matter, he's not talking about salvation here. Salvation is by faith. We're saved through the faith we have in Jesus. Jesus has saved us. So he's not talking about salvation. He's talking about the works we do. And those works will be tested by fire. It's going to come a fire test. A fire test will test the quality of our work. And if the fire goes up in smoke, it was lost. Some will suffer loss. On the day, beloved, when we stand before Jesus, some of our stuff is going up in smoke. But some will receive a reward. That's what it plainly says in the Bible. If you like, you get an example of it when Jesus is in the temple and it says a rich guy comes in with a huge offering and he kind of looks around to see everybody's staring at him and he puts in his great big gift, you know, quite fairly publicly. And then the little lady comes in with her two coins and she's hoping no one will see her and she puts in her two coins. Now, most pastors don't even look when you bring your offering, but Jesus does. And it's almost like, let the fire fall now. And then the smoke's gone. You think, wow, where did that guy's offering go? It's gone. It's gone. There's nothing there. Done without love, it profits nothing. And then the woman's gift, well, she gave what she had. It was an honest, true gift. It's like the smoke's cleared. Wow, gold, silver, precious stones. Beloved, that is going to happen to all of us. We're all going to stand before the judgment seat of God, not to see if we're saved or not. That's done. That's finished. We've been saved. Hallelujah. But Jesus wants us to do works to glorify his name, to magnify him, to exalt him. And then when he tests those, if they've been done well, honestly, there'll be rewards. There'll be rewards. Watchman Nee said that it was like this. He says, like, God gives you a pure white clothing. When you get saved, you're given white clothing. Then he gives you works to do. And he says, it's like he gives you a golden thread and you can embroider it. I love it. I was just reading yesterday in, I think it's Psalm 45. It says, the queen comes in embroidered clothing to the king. He's given me a white clothing, but he wants us to do things that he can say, well done, well done. These are things I did for you, Lord. I didn't do it to please other people. I didn't do it for conscience. I did it for you. For you. There'll be rewards. You see, we've tended not to talk about rewards. Why? Well, I think partly through a wrong understanding of grace. Because you think, well, hallelujah, it's grace, like I've been teaching here. And so we think, oh, well, it's irrelevant. No, it's not irrelevant. I just want to take 2 or 3 weeks with you to kind of round the thing out as far as I can. It's not irrelevant. Sometimes it's, we get little things that are popular in the church of God that when you put them together, they build a picture that undermines this teaching. Things like this. It's like after the worship, you know, you say to the keyboard player, forgive me, keyboard player, right? You say to the keyboard player, well done, that was lovely. And he says, oh, it wasn't me, it was the Lord. Now, that's very often that happens. Well done. Oh, it wasn't me, it was the Lord. You felt, well, I thought I saw your fingers move, you know. Or you feel like saying, who played the wrong note? I mean, I didn't hear any wrong notes this morning, right? But it's like, it wasn't me. Now, that is very common, very common. Like, well done, that wasn't me. It was, actually. When I first started going out preaching from Bible college, I used to go and preach lots of different churches around London. And you go to all these churches, and often the deacons before the thing, they would take you into the deacon's room, and they'd pray over you. And they'd pray this sort of prayer, Lord, hide the preacher this morning. We want to see Jesus only. I mean, it was a common, you often heard it. A friend of mine said, if they pray that again, he said, I'm going to go into the pulpit. I'm going to say, let us pray. He said, and then close all their eyes. He said, I'm going down under the pulpit. We'll hide the preacher. He said, let's see how they get on without me. But what do they mean? What they mean is, well, you know, we don't want this guy parading himself. We understand that. But you can get to the place, we just want Jesus. I've been in wonderful old churches where it's actually built into the wooden frame around the pulpit and actually type, sir, we would see Jesus. Well, it's a wonderful concept, wonderful. I don't rubbish it, but we can get to the place where drain pipes only, blessed master, but with all your wondrous power flowing through us. Just a drain pipe. No, that is not, that's not the Bible. God loves people. God wants to use people. The latest one I've heard more recently is a kind of charismatic one. God wants a faceless army. You heard that phrase? It's very popular in some places. God wants a faceless army. God wants a faceless army. What does that mean? Well, God hates faces. God just wants anonymity. Huh? Is that biblical? See, that'll get a big cheer from sometimes. Yeah, faceless army. No personalities. Huh? Why is Hebrews 11 written? This woman of faith. This man of faith. Why does David's army all get named? This mighty man. He did this. Another mighty man. And then there were these three. And then there were those. They did this. And all these names. All they did. The names of the spies who went into the land and didn't believe. And the spies who went in and did believe. Names. Names. Not faceless. People who will stand before God. So that whole idea, it wasn't me, it was Jesus. No, it wasn't, it was you. Thank you. Thanks for all the hours that musicians put in, all the practice, all the training, all the teamwork, all the loving preparation. Thank you, thank you. It's not anonymous. Otherwise, we kind of kill our personalities. We kill who we are. God made us in his image and likeness. He wants to reward us. So St. Ignatius of Loyola, you may have heard that name, you may not. He founded the Jesuit movement, and he gave the church a prayer, which has been prayed down through the centuries. Lord, we do all these things not looking for any reward, save that of knowing we do your will. That's a famous prayer. We do this not looking for any reward, save that of knowing we do your will. Now, again, that's a very noble thing to say, but it's not what the Bible says. It's not what the Bible says. See, one of the last things in the whole Bible, Jesus says, I'm coming. My rewards are with me. I'm coming with my rewards. And now, which of us is going to say, oh, Jesus, just slow down a minute. Angels, be quiet. Jesus, take a seat. We just feel we want to take you. You know, we would like to lift you to a higher morality. I mean, looking for rewards? I mean, Jesus. Anybody going to argue with Jesus? I'm not volunteering. No, Jesus, I'm coming with my rewards. We don't want St. Ignatius saying, we're not looking for any. Somehow it pleases Jesus. Somehow he celebrates. He wants to share the spoils. He wants to share the spoils. And so, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We want to serve the living God. Now, we don't want to do dead works. We don't want to be cutting off. I don't know why we do this. Always done it. No faith, no purpose, no meaning. We just turn up. No faith. Especially as was said earlier in the meeting, we want to open. What does God want in this meeting? What does God want in this church? What's God got for us as we lift our heads again? Well, it's not just a lot of duty work. It's serving the living God. Now, let's just conclude then with a kind of third section. A third section. Living works have a number of categories. Let me just tell you some things that are very famous to you. Works of power show what he is like. So, for instance, Mark 16:20, the Lord working with them. Working together then with God. These are Bible verses. We work with God. We're not just doing it. We don't know why. We're not just doing it not expecting anything to happen. You read that. When I was first saved and I went through this agony, I lost all my friends. My parents were not Christian. I came from a totally pagan world. Absolutely pagan. And when God suddenly dealt with me ruthlessly, said, I want your life. Not just you to go there on a Sunday, I want your life. And he'd scared the life out of me because I knew I'd been very backslidden and he'd often challenged me. And I thought, oh, I'll try harder. I was a mess. And one Sunday he spoke to me, he said, I want your life. I want it now. And then he said this, I felt, I'll not speak to you about this again. And that scared the life out of me. I knew what it was to be convicted. It's a mercy from God to be convicted. But I felt God said, this is the last time. I won't convict you again. I thought, oh, grief. And I went home and got on my knees before God. And I thought, Lord, I've got to change my life completely. So I lost all my non-Christian friends that I used to spend all my time with. I used to go to church on Sundays, but I wasn't drunk on Saturday night, often, at parties and raves and stuff. And I remember the very next Saturday, and I got on my motor scooter because I lived in Hove, and all the life was in Brighton. And I went down into Brighton again, and the buzz around the bars and all the young people, such a buzz on Saturday nights in Brighton, I loved it. And I thought, no, I've turned my back. And I went home, I put my motorbike away, and I sat, and my unsaved parents were in the other room, and I sat there, and I thought, so this is the Christian life, is it? Sitting at home on a Saturday night. I nearly died. And then I just picked up a Bible, and I started reading the book of Acts. I'd never done it before. And I just read it, and a bubble of hope just grew in my soul. I thought, boy, this wasn't boring. This wasn't boring. This was pretty exciting. This book of Acts, this is amazing stuff. And hope just, I thought, maybe there's life here. Maybe I'll find life. And I did. I did. There's no good settling for death when we found life. We found something the Holy Spirit wants to own. The Lord working with them. Galatians 2:8 says this, he who effectually worked through Peter to the Jews effectually worked through Paul to the Gentiles. All right, so you need to know the sphere. That's where I'm most meant to be working. That's where I fit. See, we're a body with many different parts. We got different parts to play. We're not all 10 pins all looking the same. We're not all clones. We're different. God loves the diversity. And living works reflect diversity. You see, dead works, they're just so boring. Everybody does the same anyway. Church isn't meant to be like that. I remember black and white television. I'm that old. You know, we thought it was good. And then, boing, it went color. So, whoa, that's a bit different. God's church is the pinnacle of his creative skill. The church is the most glorious thing on planet Earth. It is a tragedy that people say, don't go to church because it's boring. The church, wow. I mean, these David Attenborough television programs, you know, turn off the sound, but the pictures are amazing. The color, they think, God, you made all this. You made this incredible, these fish, these creatures. The diversity, the magnificence is so marvelous. The church, man, boring. But that's the church of God. So we need the diversity. We need to find what is it God's given us to do. I remember I used to visit the churches around. I went to a church in East Grinstead, and there was a guy at the door. Often he'd greet me and speak to me and say hi. And I'd say, how are you? And I'd say, oh, it's miserable. I live in this old people's home, and life is miserable. And it's like, oh, grief. And no one remembers me, and my kids aren't in touch. I thought, oh, God. And I just, okay, thank you. Nice to see you. And the next time I went, I forgot. And there he was. Hello, how are you? It's the same thing. I thought, oh, I've done it again. And then I did it a third time. I thought, oh, what? I said, brother, you're a believer, aren't you? You know Jesus. And, you know, I just had a little word with him. I'm a visitor. I didn't feel like I'm his pastor, but I had a word with him. Do you know, the next time I went, it was amazing. I saw the same guy. I said, hi, how are you going? And his face looked so different. He said, I've got a little ministry. I said, what's that then? He said, I get hold of used birthday cards when they've got a middle bit. And he said, I take the middle bit out. And he said, I put a new middle bit in. And he said, I write messages to people whose birthday it is. And I put Bible verses that I feel God impresses on my heart. And I just give to people in the church and to neighbors. So I give them these cards on their birthdays. And I just put my bit inside. And it's this fabulous copperplate writing. He said, look, here's some. And he said, some of the letters I've had back from people. I thought, wow. Wow. If you look in the lists in the New Testament, you're not going to find, and the gift of, you know, tearing out bits of, you know, you won't find it in the Bible. But he was so happy. He was so appreciated. He was blessing so many people. The body of Christ, yeah, he was inventive. He found a way of serving. And he was loving it. And people were being so blessed through him. Because living works express the love of Jesus. Living works express his will. All right, we close with this. Jesus said this, I have glorified you on the earth. I have done the work you gave me to do. That's, you say, how can I want to glorify God. Can I be Billy Graham? You know, can I be Jackie Pullinger? I want to glorify God. Oh, I want to be. No, this is how you glorify God. Jesus said, I've glorified you on the earth. I've done the work you gave me to do. You gave me to do. You know, Susanna Wesley raised John Wesley and Charles Wesley. Hudson Taylor's mother interceded for him until he came and said, God's sending me to China. Who knows what your works, your gifts, your calling. These two elderly ladies over 80 years of age prayed for revival to come to the Hebrides and it swept in. What is God? It's so different from conscience work. I better do it because what will it? No, it's not relevant. We do it to please the Lord. It says, going back to that 1 Corinthians passage, in chapter 4, the next 4, it says, it's a very small thing that I should be examined by you. It's like he couldn't care. He didn't care what people, it's a very small thing. He said, or any human court, I don't even over-examine myself. See, sometimes we're like that. How am I getting on? No, he says, I don't even bother. But he says this, I'm conscious of nothing against myself. Got a clear conscience. Yet I'm not by this acquitted. Interesting. He who examines me is the Lord. He said, I'm not really worried what you think of me. I don't even get preoccupied with what I think of me. But that doesn't mean all is well, because ultimately I'm going to be examined by the Lord. Then this verse is the most important one. Verse 5 of 1 Corinthians 4. Therefore, don't go on passing judgment. Don't judge one another. But wait till the Lord comes, who will bring to light things hidden in darkness and disclose the motives of men's hearts. Then each man's praise will come to him from God. God will bring out the things hidden in darkness. Now, one day I'll stand before God. Why did you go to Eastbourne in July 21? The things you can't see in here. He would disclose the things hidden in darkness and disclose the motives of men's hearts. Then each man will receive his praise from God. Beloved, it's the real thing. This is real. This is God. We know God. We're going to stand before God one day. He will see, what's my motive? What's your motive? Then he will judge. It's like the guy put the money in the offering, went up in smoke. Some will suffer loss. Some will receive reward. And Paul said, I'm not aware of anything against myself, but I don't trust in that, because it's God who's going to judge in the end. It's God who will judge in the end. So we want to serve the living God. We don't want conscience work. It's dead. It'll kill the church. Lots of people are doing stuff they don't want to do. You know, we do it because, well, someone's got to do it. We don't want to do it. It's conscience work. And I said, no, I want to find, what have you got for me to do? And we do it with all our hearts. I read a blog this couple of days ago from Kate Simmons, who now lives in Australia. She was a worship leader in Brighton Church, wrote some great songs. She says, God's spoken to me lately. I've got to stir up the gift within me. I've not written any songs for ages. She really felt, hey, that's the gift God gave me. I'm not doing it. He said, I want to, and she wrote a terrific blog on motivations and skills and ways to get into serving the church by giving them great songs to sing. God says, I found David who will do all my will. I found a man who will do all my will. It's like God's dancing around heaven. I found one who will do my will. And it said, when David died, he fell asleep having served the purpose of God in his generation. Oh, beloved, this is a great church. It's got great potential to impact this city. And we together find our various parts, get involved, back off from any kind of critical, no, judging one another. We don't need that. It's a waste of time. We say, no, I want in. With all my heart, I want in. I want to do it for God. That together in our poor, backslidden nation that doesn't know its right hand from its left, the world is going so fast down the pan, they don't know which is a boy and which is a girl. One of my sons is a school teacher. He's got a little girl in his class who says, I call myself a boy. The headmistress says, you mustn't call her a girl. I think, what? And the headmistress says that. That's the thought. No, she's got, what's happening in our world? I don't know if I'm a boy or a girl. Well, we get these married. What's going on? The nation's lost its way. And what's the answer? You can't legislate for it. You can't say Boris Johnson should do something. He can't do anything. You can't legislate for righteousness. It's the church of the living God. Always has been. Revival. The church coming alive. The light of the world turning on. The people in darkness see a great light. That's what we want, a glorious church. That's why I'm come to serve you as far as I know how. I want to encourage you. We're secure in grace. I don't have to do anything to justify myself. I can say, no, I won't do it, and I'm righteous. Hallelujah. But what is it God wants me to do? How is it I'm meant to glorify him? Saul of the Old Testament, he finishes by saying this, I have played the fool exceedingly. I have erred exceedingly. I've lost my way. Saul of the Old Testament, he said, my life was a waste of time. My life was a waste of time. Saul of the New Testament says this, I've run the race. I've fought the fight. Henceforth, you're thinking about it? Yes, I'm thinking about it. Henceforth, there's laid up for me. Oh, we're not looking for anything. Oh, Paul was. Henceforth, there's laid up for me a crown. Crown. He's thinking, I'm going to meet Jesus who wants to give rewards. Father, I thank you so much for this church. I thank you for its history. I thank you for your terrific love for it. Lord, thank you for every individual here, every family, everyone who works behind the scenes. Lord, in the other room, the kids and those serving the kids, loving them, playing with them, singing with them. All the technicians, all the PA, all that work that's done to make this happen. We thank you for it, Father. And we ask you, Lord Jesus, help every one of us to be secure in your grace and do the stuff you want us to do, that Jesus gets greatly glorified. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.